you're worshiping with us at Life Church today. You know, motherhood is a very exciting day for many, and for others, it's a challenging day. There are those who have lost their mothers, who've lost their children, who are wanting to become mothers. There are some who have neglectful or abusive mothers when they were growing up. There are others who are heartbroken over maybe a wayward teenager. Or perhaps they are really struggling in raising maybe a special needs child or overwhelmed by maybe a foster or adopted child situation. There's all kinds of different life situations you come into the service with today. In the scripture, we see the same type of reality. You see mothers who are struggling. You see people like Ruth, who actually was a widow, and she lost her child, and she never had a chance to have a child, I should say, at a young age, and she was childless. You see people like Hannah and Sarah, who actually were infertile and struggling with that. You see mothers like Eve and like Mary, who lost their sons in tragic situations. And so I'm not sure how you're coming to our service today. Some of you are thriving, some of you are coping, and some of you maybe are feeling like you're going under. But regardless of how you feel today, as you walk in these doors, we have a goal for you when you walk out of these doors. We want you today to feel loved. When every mother here and every woman in our service today to feel loved. In fact, we have these shirts that we want you to pick up on your way out today. The fact that you are loved is not something we question. There are a lot of gray things in life. This is not gray. It's black and white. God loves you. And we want you to feel loved. And so women, mothers, pick up this shirt on the way out today. All those who are 18 years old and older, I want you to have this as our gift for being here today. And it can be challenging, right, to this day. It can be a challenging time for all of us, for mothers. But one of our goals here today is that when you are in the service, we want you actually to leave believing in what God says about you. There are a lot of voices telling you what you're supposed to do and who you're supposed to be. There are men who'll tell you what to do and women who'll judge you about what you do. There is media and culture who will sometimes give us these views of womanhood that's distorted or motherhood that's idealized. But the question is, what does God say about you? And we want you to think about that today. What does God say about who I am? We're going to have some women share this morning. Some of our seasoned ladies and women in our church and mothers, part of our legacy ministry. And these women are going to share with you from their own life stories, the wisdom they've gathered over the years. And while they're talking to you, I want to encourage you today to think while they're speaking to you, God, who do you say that I am? God, you speak to me. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for mothers. We thank you for the mothers who gave us life, for the mothers who raised us. We thank you for the mothers who are here today and the women gathered. We thank you for all that they do. God, we pray today, Lord, that every woman here today will hear your voice, your encouragement, your affirmation. There are so many people telling women what they're supposed to be and what they're supposed to do. May it not be about what a man says or what women expect or the culture imposes. May it not even be about what we think about ourselves. But today, we want to know, what do you say? What do you say about who we are? In Jesus' name.
I'm not good enough.
You are more than enough.
I can't juggle all of this.
I will sustain you.
keep failing?
I will hold you up.
I'm so tired.
Rest in me.
I keep messing up.
I have a great plan for you.
I feel so ugly today.
You are beautiful to me.
Why can't I just get my life together?
Give it all to me. I will handle it.
I don't feel seen at all.
I see you.
I'm so lonely.
I am always with you.
In my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. Ooh, you say I am loved when I can't feel a thing, and you say you say of me. Oh, I believe the only thing that matters now is everything you think of me. In you I find my worth, in you I'll find my identity. You say of me, oh, I believe. Taking all I have now, I'm laying it at your feet. You have every failure, God, and you have every victory. Thank you.
name is Yadi Gibson, and I am a mother of four, although I also get to mother 350 kids every day at work, because I work in physical education elementary school, and that's really fun. Well, when I think about my motherhood years, one word really pops to my mind, especially after praying and thinking about just my motherhood years and what they were like, and that word is endurance. In particular, I think about that Bible verse that talks about, do not grow weary in doing good, for at the proper time you will reap a harvest if you do not give up. So as I think about mothering and I think about all of the years and all of the skinned knees, and I think about the joys and the pains and the struggles, it sort of feels like being there. It feels like standing on a place where you're unmovable and just being there for your kids or for those that are around you that need you. And regardless of what adversities may come your way, you just have made a choice that you are just going to be there. And sometimes your being there requires a lot of sacrifice, and sometimes it just feels natural. And sometimes it doesn't. And the moments when you have those late night talks are just unexpected, and you're tired and you're weary. But as the verse says, if you don't grow weary of doing the good, in time you will reap a harvest. And I have seen that in my children's lives. My oldest one is now 33 years old. She went through 3 miscarriages, and those were really difficult times. So my other kids, they have gone through difficult times as well. But that endurance, that being able to stand, that doesn't really come from myself. And I think pretty much every mother, especially a mother who's a believer and who has Christ in their heart, will say that it is Christ really who gives us the strength to endure and to be there in the really tough times, in the really hard times, when it would be easier to just pull away. But I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And I remember saying that as a mantra when I was trying to give natural birth to my now 11-year-old son. And I didn't know that I could do it. I could say, can I do this? Can I do this? And I believe that the Lord put it in my heart and my mind. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And so I encourage you, mother, as you go through the hard times, remember that the strength doesn't have to come from you, that the strength really comes from Christ alone, that you can lean on him, and that when you think you have nothing else to give, when you're just tired and spent, and you have given it your all, and many times during motherhood that happens, just remember that there's someone that you can lean on, and Christ will always be there for you, and he will provide you with the strength and endurance that you need. Happy Mother's Day.
Good morning, church. Happy Mother's Day. You know, some of my greatest blessings call me mom. And I think that you all can understand when I say that. But I'm up here to talk to you today about feeling worthy. Worthy is the Lamb of God. Can we ever aspire to being that great and that perfect? I think we can. God tells us that in his scripture. He tells us that we are created by him, that we are loved with an everlasting love. His workmanship created us. He filled us with the fullness of himself so that we are part of his family. We are purchased by Christ. We are blameless, chosen, forgiven, and we are redeemed, free and victorious. Dear ones, are you listening to the whispers of the enemy and feeling like you are not enough? Stop it. Stop listening to him and start proclaiming that God is true. You are his. He created you and you were chosen by him. He loves you and has a purpose for you. Live in the truth of God's word, and the truth will set you free. You are worthy. Once upon a time, several decades ago, I was born in Brooklyn to a Jewish couple. My father was overseas fighting in the Battle of the Bulge, and we never met until I was 13 months old. Mom was a commercial artist, and Dad was an attorney who ultimately became a professor and a prolific writer of law books and occasional fiction. I had one younger sister. We moved to our first home on Long Island, and then Dad took a teaching job in Cleveland, Ohio. That's where I attended middle school and high school. I studied very hard and ultimately earned early placement to the University of Michigan in my junior year of high school. Dad thought that 2 years at Michigan would suffice, since I'd probably meet an eligible man to marry, and therefore wouldn't need a degree, since my husband would take care of me from then on. Well, I met my husband, but Dad consented to let me stay and finish my degree in early education. I actually supported my husband in his final year in engineering. When he graduated, we hustled down to Baytown. That's in Texas. In time to have Exxon send a letter to his draft board stating that Exxon would not survive without his expertise in blending the fuel for the Apollo 11 flight. That was God, because God, since otherwise he would have had to serve in Vietnam. We bought our first house in Baytown, and I had my daughter and my son. Watergate happened. Then the oil business caused us to wait in long gasoline lines to fill our cars. Venezuela wanted to nationalize their oil, so my husband was offered a 2-year stint in Caracas. Living there was filled with frustrations, even though I had a maid and all the free time that I could use. I had already filled my head with all the women's movement ideas of equality and had become quite depressed until my feet landed on U.S. soil once again. It was 1976, and the country was celebrating its bicentennial birthday. I kissed the ground on our arrival home. We moved back to the Houston area to Clear Lake next to the NASA Space Center. Within our first year at home, my first husband and I divorced, and I had to face my future as a single mom with two growing kids. It was then that I applied to nursing school. I had to retake several courses in order to enter the nursing program, which lasted for 2 years. I lived on child support and some night nursing jobs on weekends. My kids used to stay by themselves when I worked because we had no choice. Guardian angels definitely watched over them. I worked as an obstetric nurse upon graduation and finally bought my own house and my own car in my name. After 4 years as a single mom, I met and married my current husband, Bill. We moved to Colorado for about a year and then back to Texas. I worked as a labor and delivery nurse for 33 long years until I was forced to quit due to my back fusion surgery. It was then that I literally prayed to God to show me what I was supposed to be doing going forward, including meeting new people. I needed new friends. God came through with a whole new life, because I began volunteering at Agape Pregnancy Resource Center in Round Rock, where I learned what it meant to serve the Lord. On Easter Sunday that spring, I got a door tag from Life Church. So my daughter and her family and I attended our first time, and we fell in love with the church and its members. My grandsons attended summer camp and became involved with the youth ministry. My oldest grandson, my daughter, and I decided to be baptized at church, and so began my Christian walk. It's been 9 or 10 years, and I feel the love and sanctifying from my Lord and Savior Jesus. Mother's Day is special to me, especially because I'm now the matriarch of my family. I have seen many changes in my long decades of life, but today I want to encourage all of you mothers and other women to accept from me this simple message that Jesus is truly the way, the truth, and the light. How else could a Brooklyn Jewish girl have become so in love with Jesus? These days are so filled with worldly challenges to we women, especially to the younger women. Our identities have become so worldly, and we are daily faced with the challenges to be all to everyone around us. The pandemic simply brought these challenges front and center, and social networks drive them home to us daily. Please teach yourselves that Jesus is a far better pursuit than acquiring money, looks, and relationships. I finally found a relationship with my Lord that has sustained me in this last decade or so of my life, and I can leave this life knowing that I'll meet my Savior face to face. All of you are so loved, no matter your circumstances, and I pray that you will feel the ultimate joy of falling in love with Jesus Christ. I would love to talk to you about my journey, and I want to encourage you to follow my lead, because I know you won't regret it. Scripture has a perfect description of a worthy woman, and I'd like to read that to you right now. It's part of Proverbs 31. It calls her the wife of noble character, and I consider noble character pretty worthy. Speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all, A wife of noble character who can find. She is worth far more than rubies. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. She selects wool and flax and works with her hands. She is like the merchant ships bringing her food from afar. She gets up while it is still night. She provides food for her family and portions for her female servants. She considers a field and buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. She sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her tasks. She sees that her trading is profitable, and her lamp does not go out at night. In her hand, she holds the distaff and grasps the spindle with her fingers. She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. When it snows, she has no fear for her household, for all of them are clothed in scarlet. She makes coverings for her bed. She is clothed in fine linen and purple. Her husband is respected at the city gate, where he takes his seat among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them and supplies the merchants with sashes. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Honor her for all that her hands have done, and let her works bring her praise at the city gates. Consider this almost unattainable example, but I urge you, every day, baby steps, we'll all make it someday. Thank you.
I'm Lauren DeVore. I just wanted to share a little bit of my story with you. I grew up not feeling very adequate. I was adopted as a baby, but never knew why I was given up for adoption. Even though my parents who raised me were very loving and accepting of me as their non-biological child, I felt that they were much more intelligent and gifted than I was, and that I just didn't measure up. I never excelled in academics or athletics or much of anything, except in sarcasm and making people laugh. Although my parents did love me very much, almost too much, I didn't feel very deserving of love, partly due to my shortcomings and partly due to lots of other things that were going on in my life, sins committed against me and those of my own, and eventually alcohol abuse. So I became a people pleaser, trying to get people to like me. And then I tried to be a God pleaser by going to church and youth group every week and even sang in the youth choir. I went on local mission trips and youth camps trying to please God until I finally heard the good news that God created me and loves me just the way I am. The God who created the universe, the most powerful being ever, loves me. Try to wrap your mind around that. He loves us, not just people in general, but you and me individually. He wants to have a relationship with us, and his love is unconditional. You couldn't earn it if you tried. So for those who come to know God, nothing in the world can separate them from his love. God is faithful, and he'll never forsake those who have trusted in him. When we begin a relationship with him, we don't just become God's friend, we become his child. And as a good parent, God wants what's best for us. He wants to guide us and fill our life with joy, even when trials come, because they do. We may think that we're able to please God by being a good person because we haven't murdered anyone, or we think we've done more good things than bad, so we're okay. But that's a lie. We've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Even sins like coveting or using the Lord's name in vain deserve punishment from God, who is holy and just. And that punishment is spiritual death, which means spending eternity without God. Also, Satan lies to us by saying that God would never love us because of our sin. But we need to dispel these lies and replace them with God's truth, that his free gift of salvation is available to each of us who's willing to confess our sins and ask for forgiveness. God loves us so much that he sent his only son so that whoever believes in him will not perish but will have eternal life, which starts a moment we believe. And Christ died for us while we were still sinners, even when we've been prideful or downright unlovable. We don't think we deserve God's love, no matter how religious we think we are, but he loves us anyway. This is grace. God loves you and me so much that he paid the price that we owed but could never pay. And his death and resurrection was adequate. No works are needed on our part. Because of his love, all we need to do is accept his work on the cross and say yes to God. He wants to adopt us, just as we are, into his family because he wants us, just like my parents did. So I was adopted twice. But you can't just know this in your head. You need to truly place your trust in Christ, just like I did at youth camp. And it stuck, even after living life my own way without Christ in the center for over a decade and then some. When I was finally ready to come back to the Lord, I found him ready and willing to take me back into fellowship with him. He had been patiently knocking at the door of my heart, which reminds me of the stained glass window at the church where I came back to the Lord. God's love means there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ, even when we slip up, which I do daily. Since his will is that none of us would perish, my prayer is that each of you will acknowledge your need for salvation, trust in the death and resurrection of Christ, and ask for his forgiveness. If you do this, you will be assured of your eternal salvation, and God will bless you immensely. You'll experience God's perfect love, and we'll see God working in many ways, such as my prayer to connect with my birth family, if that was God's will. Decades after I prayed that, God said yes, and now I have a relationship with my birth family, kind of like being adopted even one more time. And I got to meet my birth mom, hear her story, and thank her for making such a huge sacrifice for me. And I got to see firsthand where my snarkiness came from. Maybe it's not a spiritual gift, but it's got to be genetic, right? And God has blessed me with three amazing kids of my own and a wonderful husband to help raise them. Over the years, I've often felt inadequate as a wife and mother and have made lots of mistakes. But despite my shortcomings, our kids have grown up to be wonderful, talented, loving adults who know how much God loves them. 1 John 4:10 says, "This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." I hope you come to know and remember that truth whenever you feel inadequate or unlovable, because you are, we all are, but God is adequate and God is love.
Could it be that really easy that you love me like you say you do? I've got years and years of striving when there was nothing left to prove. Could it really be this simple? Your kindness changes everything. It's like your grace is on a mission to tear down my religion. You're all I really need. Hallelujah. All this time, how you love me, how you love me. Hallelujah, it blows my mind, how you love me, how you love me. Oh, how you love me. Could it be I'm finally seeing that you're not who I thought you'd be? You're not mad and you're not scary, and all the shame and guilt I've carried is why you died for me. How you loved me. Hallelujah, it blows my mind. How you love me. Oh, how you love me. How you love me when I'm broken. How you love me when I'm weak. When I'm all out of options. When I can't bring you anything. How you love me. how you love me.
Caught the overlying theme for today? Each of us are talking about one of God's promises. Promises. Wow, that's a really big word. But you know what? We have a really big God. We are worthy. We are loved. He provides us with endurance. And yes, we can have joy. We do have to choose to be joyful in a sense. But he does give us the spirit within us to do so. We read in Romans, "For the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit." How do you live joyfully? I really don't know, other than believing in God's promises. I did some research the other day, and one source told me that there are 8,810 promises of God in the Bible. And 7,487 of them were for mankind. Another source said that there were 7,147 promises to mankind. I really wasn't expecting that. It just really made me think, God promises. That in and of itself is a pretty powerful statement. But no matter how many there are, we have a choice to make. Do we believe them or not? Do I get to pick and choose which ones I want to believe? I'm not really sure that that's what God had in mind, but that seems to be what we do. I do think as we grow in our faith, we become to believe more and more of these promises. So today, I want to share with you my joy journey. I guess it's just kind of how I've matured in the Lord. I've had this amazing phenomenon happening in the last several years. I just can't seem to get away from it. And it started very subtly. When I'd sit down, I'd hear this, "Ooh." It happened a few times, and I thought, I sound like my mother. Then the bones started creaking, snap, crackle, pop, just started here and there, but it got more frequent and it got louder. Next, there was the gray hair, and the hair that was in places where it was not supposed to be. Then there were the jars, and the childproof caps, and finally the Propel bottles that I can't always seem to get open. But there are so many, many more, the eyeglasses, the wrinkles, and those letters from AARP. I remember the time my husband and I went to the movies, and the cost was cheaper than we were expecting. And I just looked at him and said, "They gave you the senior discount." And as I was reveling in the fact that he was 5 years older than me, he looked up the pricing, smiled, and looked at me and said, "Yes, and they gave it to you too." It was true, I was getting older. But there are good things that come with getting older too. Grandkids, paid off mortgages, more knowledge and life experience. We can volunteer more, and yes, those senior discounts. But it's also a time of reflection. I can look back and see God's hand in both the good and the challenging times. James 1, 2 and 3 says, "Consider it nothing but joy, brothers and sisters, whenever you fall into various trials. Be assured that the testing of your faith through experience produces endurance, leading to spiritual maturity and inner peace." It's easy to be joyful when things are going well, but it's in the trials where the choice really becomes more difficult. Was I joyful when my toddler was throwing temper tantrums all the time? It started slowly, just at home, and then at the babysitter's, and then at church. I remember we tried everything we knew to do. Jason would just fling himself about and shout and scream so loud that by the time he finally did stop, he immediately fell asleep from exhaustion. We tried everything we knew to do, and it lasted for about 2 years. The climax for me was when we were sitting in McDonald's and he started throwing a tantrum. We couldn't get him to stop. I remember just sitting down and starting to cry and crying until he finally did stop. Was I joyful as a young mom? I'm not really sure, but I had a hope that things would get better, and eventually they did. And I kept learning more about God's word and growing. For a season, we were foster parents. The first time the child that we had was the same age as our son. I thought that would be a really good thing. But they were in the same class in school. They went to the same class at church. David became Jason's shadow. They shared the same TV shows, the same toys, and he would want to do everything that our son did. After a while, we realized that Jason was subconsciously pulling his hair out. He had a bald spot on the back of his head where when he would sit and watch TV or whatever, he would just pull at it. So we had to give this child up. Were we failures as foster parents? Was I joyful? I really don't remember, but I kept going to church and I kept serving and learning more about God. Then there was the business that failed. We had no income, no food, and we ended up losing our home, but God provided. We had to reach out to our church, and food came by the carload, and I mean a lot. And we moved into a cheaper home. Was I joyful? I know I had questions, but by then at least I knew that God would provide. Psalm 28:7 says, "The Lord is my strength and my shield, and I trust him with all of my heart. He helps me, and my heart is filled with joy. I will burst out into songs of thanksgiving." Well, I don't know that I was bursting out with songs of thanksgiving or that my heart was filled with joy, but at least I was trusting him and I was growing. Then there were the times when my husband couldn't find work, but the jobs finally came. And once I came back to my job after a family vacation and was told I was fired. How was this going to impact us? Was I joyful? Well, I chose to believe that God was in control, and I went about looking for another job, and God provided. Trials came and went, life happens. But as Christians, we can learn through them and choose to believe we are worthy and choose joy. I decided to be joyful when we moved in with my aging parents. My mom had Alzheimer's. She called me Jenny. That was her sister who died when I was a junior in high school. I chose to take care of her and still be joyful. Then my dad started showing Alzheimer's symptoms. He was also clinically diagnosed, and eventually he stopped calling me by my name. But he still knew I was his daughter, and I chose joy. Later, they both passed, first my dad, and 3 months later, my mom. I chose joy. In Romans, it tells us, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with the hope and power of the Holy Spirit." The first time I really remember thinking that perhaps I could have joy in all situations was about 10 years ago, when I was struggling to even walk. I would have to stand up by my desk or whatever was near me and use it as a crutch to get started. I got to where I really couldn't walk very far, and other symptoms were creeping in. I finally went to see our family doctor, and he was concerned that I had MS. It was going to be about 4 to 6 weeks before I could get in to see a specialist. And I remember that during that time, I decided I was going to be joyful. I wasn't going to let Satan have the victory by wallowing in self-pity or doubt God. I wasn't asking why me. I guess I thought, why not me? I knew I could be joyful and happy in my faith if that was to be my diagnosis. As it turned out, I didn't have MS, or I was healed by the time I got to the specialist. I slowly started feeling better, and the symptoms started fading. I chose joy. I recently read that joy is a small word carrying the big gift of our soul's delight. It's often found between life's happy moments and today's gratitude. However, during a letdown or a loss, it may feel like that delight disappears beneath the shadows of doubt or despair. Joy rises where it is welcome. Do you welcome joy? In July of 2017, my husband was diagnosed with cancer. And yes, it was his diagnosis, but I shared the experience with him about as much as a spouse possibly can. He fought diligently, but 2 years ago, God called him home, and I chose joy. Was I sad and heartbroken? Of course. We'd been married over 48 years. Suddenly the verse, "Weeping may last through the night, but joy comes in the morning," really came alive to me. You see, in all the years and all the decades, the experiences, and yes, the trials have taught me many, many things. One is that you can believe that God's promises and you can have a joyful life. After each one of those situations, I could have thrown up my hands and said, "Lord, this is too much." And he would have put his loving arms around me and still loved me. But I chose to believe that God is in control and that things would get better. As I was trying to decide on my topic for today, one of my devotions was on the subject of joy. And I think that's kind of why I picked that topic. But I'd like to read that devotion to you. "It's time to come alive again. Time to rejoice and jump into your season of joy. You've been in the desert long enough. You've trudged through the wilderness. Now, however, it's time for you to take God's hand and take that decisive step into breakthrough. Believe it or not, the decision to blossom with beauty is your choice. Though we can't always force our circumstances to change, we can gain a fresh perspective. It's possible to be thrown into the lion's den and come out unscathed. It's empowering when we learn to sing in the fire. There's beauty and mystery to be found in the most difficult times of life. And while we wait for our never-ending list of prayer requests to be answered, we mustn't waste a single moment in anxiety. Let's break our agreements with impatience, confusion, and heaviness, and choose to find joy." In my office before I moved here, I had a plaque that says, "It is what it is." One of my coworkers ran across it one day and gave it to me because I said that so much. And I do say it a lot. But it really does apply in our Christian walk. God's promises are what they are. We can choose to believe them, or we can let them remain just words on a page. It does come down to a choice. We can believe we are loved and accept that love. We can know we are worthy and rejoice in the love and forgiveness. We can choose to keep on keeping on and endure during those difficult times. And we can choose to move forward in joy through the power of the Holy Spirit. Today, I challenge you to accept these promises, to believe that God truly does mean what he says. You are loved. You are worthy.